music, a whole lot of creepy, and many things that are truly, truly outrageous on this episode of WatchBots!
Hi everyone, welcome to WatchBots, the podcast about old kid shows and mixing music and science into a wonderful miasma. Did I say my name?
Nope.
I'm Ben. Joined tonight by Shailen.
Hello.
Hi, and Dave.
What's up, Big Nugs?
Off to a strong start.
Did I say my name?
If you can't remember your name, the two of us will. For sure.
Maybe.
Yeah, we might.
Yeah.
Who are you?
15 seconds in. I forgot things. We're doing good.
Solid.
We're starting strong. How the hell is everyone doing?
Superb. Thanks for asking. I would even go so far as to call myself outrageous.
Yes.
Truly so?
Truly. Truly, truly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm doing well. I saw the new Lion King trailer today. Did you guys see that?
I am against it.
Yes.
So no, I have not watched it.
Okay.
The trailer or the movie?
It's the trailer of the live action movie.
Okay. But what is Ben against the trailer or the movie?
The movie and therefore the trailer.
Okay. How is it, Dave?
I don't know. It's like a shot for shot remake of The Lion King. Just with CGI animals instead of two dimensionally animated animals. I don't like this run of Disney live action movies. Do either of you?
So I haven't seen any of them. No, wait, I did. I saw Beauty and the Beast. I was okay with that, but I had some reservations. And the rest of them, I don't understand why. Like Beauty and the Beast answered questions that weren't answered in the original.
Thank God.
I had so many questions after watching it.
I hate you both. But like the animal ones, like Jungle Book, I don't understand.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Lion King, I don't understand, but I'll definitely pay money to see it. Dumbo, I was supposed to see last weekend, and I would have just cried the whole time.
So why would you see The Lion King?
I don't know. I just feel like I should.
See, this is my problem with The Lion King, is that it seems upsetting, you know?
Right.
Because knowing what happens in The Lion King with Mufasa... And then seeing that played out with like a CGI supposed to be real lion, like that's a fucking bummer.
Yeah, that hits even harder.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
yeah.
I also don't get it. Like, I watched or tried to watch The Jungle Book, like the live action one from a few years ago. And there's some newer scenes, but like they didn't really elevate the story any more than like the animated one did from the 60s or wherever. Like, so it's just like, why are they doing it besides money? And I think like, that's probably what The Lion King is going to do. Maybe have a couple new scenes or something, but like ultimately just be the exact same story with the exact same lessons.
Yeah. I mean, with Dumbo, it kind of makes sense to me because they've legitimately like changed a lot of the story and they've taken out a lot of like the racial stereotypes that were in there.
Sure.
And so it's, you know, they're remaking it for a new generation in a way that's socially acceptable and like more understanding of things that people didn't like.
But that's Dumbo.
Right. Yeah. Well, this is where I'm going with it.
Okay.
Like,
okay.
So Dumbo, I get it. Jungle Book had opportunities for stuff like that. And okay, like there's a little bit of that. All the rest of them, like why though? That's what I keep asking. I'm like, but...
Well, you got to make that cheddar. I mean, let's not look at it as anything other than what it is. It's to make money.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I understand that. Yeah. But like, I'm not going to see the movie unless it like brings something new to the story. Like, I'm just talking from my point of view. Like, I totally understand Disney's.
Yeah, I think that's fair. And I mean, it's Disney, right? And this extends into other media. So we saw the Aladdin musical last summer, and it was technically really cool.
I want you to know that at the end of that musical, I felt really proud of your boy.
Well, that's the thing, right? Is that it was the movie you watched, but it was a worse version because they added in cut material. So they added in a few Alan Menken songs that were cut for good reason because they're not very good.
So well, some of them are written specifically Menken's? For the stage.
I think most of those were written for the movie, though. I don't want to get into semantics, though, because we're going to debate things that neither you nor I know for sure.
That's fair.
Okay.
But I feel like when you go to a Broadway show, like, that's an experience, right? Mm-hmm. And so that has a leg up on painting Will Smith blue.
I don't know, baby. When I go to the movie theater, I get myself a popcorn, a 3-pound soda. That's an experience.
I just can't believe somebody blew Will Smith. That's amazing.
That movie looks like an atrocity.
Yeah, I was going to say, of all the live-action ones, like Jungle Book, Lion King, Dumbo, whatever, Aladdin.
Beauty and the Beast.
Aladdin probably looks the worst. Actually, not probably, assuredly looks the worst.
And yet I'll still probably end up seeing it because I really liked Aladdin. And then I'm going to leave the theater angry. I'm going to be disappointed. I'm going to ask myself, why did I do this? But I'll still go through with it. And that's a question that lingers. Mm-hmm. Why? Why do I do these things?
Disney, call me up when you're remaking Bedknobs and Broomsticks for a new generation.
Yeah.
But that is also all CGI animals. You know?
It's going to be the CGI Angela Lansbury. Is that who's in that one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
What's an old looking animal? An owl? That's kind of on the nose.
A pug?
Sure.
Pugs are old.
Yeah. Pugs are old yes. looking.
They're old looking is what I meant.
I'm just into the idea that they take Angela Lansbury and just make her a CGI, like the same age she was when Bedknobs and Broomsticks was originally made. Mm-hmm.
Andy Serkis did the mocap, and for Angela Lansbury's character from the Bedknobs and Broomsticks live action remake. It was awesome.
He's also going to do that for the Murder, She Wrote CGI reboot.
Oh, man. Yes.
Well, if you like CGI reboots, get at us at Twitter at WatchBotsPod, hashtag CG Guy or C Girl.
And if you don't like CGI reboots, hashtag CGI Repoop.
You took the low road out, but I accept it.
Hey, you laughed.
It's true. So mea culpa of the week, and I will be honest with you guys, I have thought about pulling this segment out of the rotation because in our 20 episodes, we've really grown by leaps and bounds.
For sure.
So I will open the floor. So speak now or potentially forever hold your peace.
I am in favor of cutting the segment routinely, but I think we have to leave the door open for when inevitably one of us says something that needs to be brought up. Mm-hmm.
I second Shailen's opinion. So we don't have to make this a reoccurring segment and force content into it. But if something comes up, yeah, we should definitely call each other out.
And with that in mind, who fucked up this week?
Oh, it was me. When it sounded like I was calling out Ben's brother and not Ben over the toys. I'm still harboring an awful lot of guilt over that.
Well, I mean, when you play the audio, it's clear that you're calling out my poor brother who couldn't even be on the show to defend himself.
But what I was trying to do was say he knew you liked the toys and he knew you would steal the toy. And so he kindly gave it to our son so he could be a good brother.
Right.
Yeah. Didn't come out that way.
No, it didn't.
No. That's okay.
No, not at all. Nope.
No, I know.
All right.
Big old Shailen culpa. Yeah. So the three of us got together in person on Sunday and watched WrestleMania. And
don't tell people my secrets.
Shailen, you fell asleep on the couch next to me, and I unleashed a brisket-induced fart on you several times. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sorry about it, but mea culpa.
Your confession is disgusting, but you're forgiven.
I don't know why.
I can't believe you confessed.
Well, I don't know why at my own house I was holding in farts. Like I had like a vicious like I mean, it was a shark donut. I had a shark donut for hours. And I guess I didn't want to leave in the middle of that hot wrestling action.
That was so thrilling. I slept through a part of it.
Yeah, but you would sleep through like 9/11.
That's not true. I mean, except unless it was a depressive episode, which I think is totally justified.
Yeah. That's not to say... God, I'm going to keep digging a hole.
Dig that hole.
It's not making light of 9/11. It's to say that you sleep through almost anything.
I don't know, Ben. It kind of sounded like you were making fun of 9/11 there.
Yeah. It's like when we had the marathon tragedy in Boston. Shailen was at our house that we lived at the time, and she just fainted on the ground.
That didn't happen.
It's a narcoleptic response to trauma. I get it.
It's not trauma. It's stress-induced and usually related to sports. I've missed every Celtics triumph.
All one of them in the past 30 years?
Yeah. It's a weird example, but okay.
I remember like several games in that series, though, like waking up to Ben going, so the Celtics won again.
Nice relevant content. That was over a decade ago.
Yikes.
Anyway, sorry for leaving a giant shark donut on your couch and by your head, okay. Shailen. I apologize. Mea culpa.
What a quality segment.
So cheerful.
Yes. So, on to this week, and we are talking about another child of the 80s, and that is Jem. And Dave, you made this pick for reasons that I'm not sure of, but clue us in.
Yeah, so I don't know why I picked this episode either. I think
strong
Shailen...
start.
Yeah. I don't know. That's it. I think Shailen had mentioned it. After one of our recordings, Shailen had mentioned like a list of shows that we could talk about. And I was like, oh, Jem, that sounds... My sister loved Jem. So I knew you were going to ask this question, Ben. Why did I pick this show?
Sure.
And I don't have an answer, but I thought maybe I'd go to my older sister for an answer. So I texted her. I'm going to read our compelling interview because I do hard-hitting research when I prep for this show. So I'm going to read our text message back to you and just kind of give you my sister's reasoning why I chose this show. Did you watch a lot of Jem when we were little? Yes, I love that show. One of my favorites. Jem and the Holograms, LOL. Tell me more about it. What did you love about it? I remember I liked the hair colors and how she went from a normal girl to a rock star. I don't remember much else. LOL. Haha. Okay. Do you recall how or where you watched it? Just at home. It was probably on Saturday mornings. Is this for your cartoon show? It is. Did you have a ritual when you watched it? Like, did you eat a snack with it? Oh, I don't remember. What do you remember about the show? The colorful costumes and hair and being excited to watch it. Did you have any Jem toys? I remember you had something with green hair. I think so, but I can't remember. So that was the hard-hitting interview. Not a lot there. She did not remember a thing about apparently her favorite show that she loved.
Well, thank you for reading that whole exchange.
Yeah, so I just thought, you know what? This is compelling stuff. I need to share this whole thing. So my research just immediately went down the toilet. So I don't really have an answer for you, Ben. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah.
I mean, first episode of a great cartoon, or more clearly, a cartoon that we all have great memories of, that maybe doesn't live up to them, maybe does, hard to say.
I guess we'll see.
Ooh.
I do take offense, though, to your sister calling this your cartoon show, because this is art. Bad art, you know?
Art is art, though.
That's true. It's all in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah. My daughter would call this an art donut.
I like that.
Thanks.
So I am sure that I watched this show at some point, but I don't remember it. But I feel like I know it intimately. You know what I mean? It's like it's ingrained in my id somewhere. Like I couldn't tell you anything about the show, but I'm like, yeah, this sounds right.
I watched a lot of Jem.
Sure.
And we had... two Jem dolls at our house. One was my sister's and one was mine. Jem, you know, they tried to do the Barbie and the Rockers thing, like competing, whatever.
Yeah.
The Jem doll was...
outrageous.
Truly outrageous.
Truly.
She also was a giant among Barbies. So because we just had the two and they were the same doll, like I had a hand-me-down one, my sister had her own. So we just had two of the blonde with a pink streak and the earrings. And so mm-hmm. the cool thing about Jem's earrings is that you could push the magic earring and they would blink.
Yeah, I remember that.
Fuck.
So cool. They were not star-shaped, though. Just throwing that out there. Mm. But Jem couldn't wear Barbie's clothes.
Because she was too tall.
Because she was too big.
Yeah.
And so she always looked kind of like a walk of shame, like... at the end of the night, like always.
Yeah. I've got some problems with Jem's dimensions that we'll get into here, but
anybody's dimensions. But yeah, sure. We can dive into it. Yeah.
But the dolls, I mean, they were great, and you would fight over them because like they had the pink hair and the blinky earrings, and then she could either wear the dress that she came with, mm-hmm. or she just looked like she forgot pants and was wearing a t-shirt and probably needed to be hospitalized. Like,
who among us could say different?
You couldn't like pull the Velcro pieces together in the back of the shirt, so it would just be kind of be open. Yeah, I think the walk of shame look is pretty apt, Shailen. That's a good one.
Thank you.
I like that. I applaud you for your joke.
That's how we know it's good.
Yeah. I don't know how to cope with that.
Oh, she fell asleep. So the development of Jem, not entirely dissimilar to G.I. Joe. Hasbro, the toy company, commissioned Sunbow, which was a marketing company, to create a series, ostensibly for girls. So the mind behind this one is Christy Marks, and she is super prolific. So she wrote on Ninja Turtles and Conan and like 100 other things, a big fantasy sci-fi person. So really, really interesting portfolio. Now, interestingly, as opposed to a lot of the shows that we've watched, Jem did not start off as its own standalone, right? So it started off as kind of part of a variety show almost. It was called Super Sunday. So it aired starting in 1985, and it had Jem, Bigfoot, and the Muscle Machines, robotics, and inhumanoids. And they would just play like 6-minute clips to get you to the 25 minutes. Okay. So the episode that we watched actually played over 3 Sundays. Jem was the only one of those shows to go past Super Sunday. So Bigfoot and the Muscle Machines was about monster trucks. Robotics actually had a fairly successful toy line. They were kind of like Erector's sets.
I remember that name.
Yeah.
But I don't remember a cartoon.
Did you ever see the movie Jack?
Yeah.
I always remember the kid in Jack referring to a boner as an Erector set. I've never heard that before.
I thought you were going to connect this back to the cartoon that we just watched, and I was like, where is he going with this?
Give me a minute. I'll Rain Man over there.
And I've heard it since, because you use it a lot.
I do?
Yeah. Yeah, you're always talking about your Erector set.
I truly have nothing to say. But anyway, so Jem expanded past Super Sunday and was huge. Like, it was the number one watched syndicated cartoon in 1986, so when it came into its own. And in 1987, it was the number 3 kids show overall.
Wow.
Don't ask me what the other ones were, because I don't have that information.
Okay.
But, you know, so we had 3 seasons, 65 episodes, toys, records, a live-action movie in 2015. That was a bomb.
Yeah, I never actually ended up seeing the movie. I will. Like, it's still on my list. Mm-hmm. But they also came out with the comics, like the rebooted comics.
Yeah.
Which I didn't... I've read the first issue, and there were a couple of things that when I was reading it, I was like, I don't know about this, guys. This isn't the Jem I remember. As it turns out, I don't remember the cartoon as well as I thought I did anyway, so I was just being a snob, as it turns out. But
did you, like, rip up the comic and be like, you're ruining my childhood?
No, I politely returned it to the student who let me borrow it. Mm-hmm. And I said, I appreciate you letting me read this. And I never went back. Because sometimes I'm pleasant.
Okay. All right. Fine.
Not to either of you, but in general.
I hate when people claim like remakes are ruining their childhoods. What do you guys think about that when you hear that line?
Oh, I get fucking pissed. I flip the table.
Fuck you. You're not ruining. No one's ruining anything.
I guess I just kind of feel sad for people that, like, some kind of addendum can ruin a thing that way. Like, when it's fiction. I think it's different if, you know, you find out the actor who played Elmo was diddling little kids on the side. Like, yeah, that's alarming.
Jesus Christ.
That would ruin things for me. But when it's like, oh, a remake of a cartoon, yeah, that shouldn't ruin your life.
Six of one, half dozen of the other on that one.
I'm saying they're different things. Specifically.
Sure. I mean, I like things for what they are in a lot of cases. You know? So all these Netflix shows, here's an example, right? There was that new Netflix series by Matt Groening, and it was set in fantasy times, and I can't remember the name, which is fucking pathetic. But just because it's not as good as The Simpsons, or The Simpsons isn't as good as it used to be, it doesn't ruin anything.
Right.
Just accept things for what they are and call shit shit. Like, it's fine. Everybody needs to chill out.
Yeah, I didn't like the most recent Ghostbusters movie.
Because you hate women.
Heathen.
Yes, I do. That aside, the movie wasn't good. But it didn't affect my love of the first two Ghostbusters movies. Like, it didn't ruin anything for me. I wasn't like, oh God, or tearing things up and throwing things around and striking people. Like, it was just like, oh, it's they made this movie, it didn't work, but it doesn't change the other two movies at all. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I just hate when people say that ruined my childhood.
When Last Jedi came out, I was so frustrated. I came home from the movie theater and I just burned the fucking house down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't do that again.
Need that insurance money. Now we're committing it to the internet, though. Anyway, so the episode we watched is called The Beginning, which is very apt. And it aired on October 6th. 13th and 20th of 1985. Now, for you nerds out there, contextual feeling will be based off of October 6th, okay?
Got it.
Square. So here's contextual feeling. And I don't have a song. I'm working on it. And I realize that I've built this up for 6 weeks now. So nothing that I ever insert will be as good as you want it to be.
Okay.
But that's okay. I thrive under pressure.
That's what she said.
Not like our president. Anyway, at the movie theater, number one in its first week, Commando.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was in my 20s when I saw Commando for the first time. And I feel like I missed out by not seeing it sooner.
Do you think it changed your life not seeing it early on?
Imagine if I had seen it sooner in life. Maybe I would have appreciated more things.
A lot more death-related puns.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think your take on Commando when you watched it in your 20s, Shailen, really ruined my childhood because I loved Commando. I think I saw it when I was 11 and it was the best fucking movie in the world.
Yeah, it's still the best fucking movie in the world. Yeah,
that's true.
It's great. Number two, also in its first week, Jagged Edge, which starred Glenn Close, Jeff Bridges, and Robert Loggia and was a courtroom drama. I swear to God, we come on this show every week and I go, number two was a courtroom drama. There were so many fucking courtroom dramas. It's insane.
We've talked about Jagged Edge before.
It's possible.
Yeah.
Number three, Agnes of God. Have either of you ever heard of this movie?
Nope.
Okay. Here's a plot synopsis. It's about a novice nun who gives birth and insists that the dead child was the result of a virgin conception. A psychiatrist and the mother superior of the convent clash during the resulting investigation. Do you want to know how it ends?
Yes.
Not Immaculate Conception.
Spoiler alert. Just warning all you listeners. If you haven't seen Agnes of God, I'm going to spoil it. Now, the nun gets stigmata, and she's declared not guilty by reason of insanity and goes back to the convent. And it's not firmly established if it was an Immaculate Conception or not.
Huh.
But
wait.
In a Cloverfield fashion, it does lead directly into the later movie Stigmata.
I can't tell if you're joking.
Doesn't matter. Music. Number one song. So this is weird. Number one song was Oh Sheila by Ready for the World. I have no idea what song that is.
The name of it sounds familiar, but I don't have a tune. Mm-hmm.
I think I remember that. You know, remember that they used to, after Saturday Night Live, they would have the infomercials with the CDs of all the greatest hits of people.
Time Life.
That song would come up. It was one of the all the songs they didn't play were in white. And then the yellow text would be the songs they played. And I think it goes, this is probably going to be a mea culpa for next week, but I think I think it just goes, oh, Sheila, and then something. I don't remember the other words.
And then it cuts to the next song on the compilation.
Yeah. So I've never heard the song beyond that.
Okay. Well, you know what? We're going to do a little something live on the air for you folks.
Ooh. Oh, yeah?
Hold on. I'm excited. I'm typing. But I'm bantering. We're going to fucking pull it up right now.
Laughing on my side. It's good for the gays. It's always good for the gander. I'm Shyla.
That'll do. A lot of Jerry curls, and the singer looks like Dave Chappelle's Prince.
Okay. Yeah.
So this was a worthwhile diversion. Other top songs. This is why this is weird. Number two is Money for Nothing.
Oh.
And number three was Take on Me. So why?
Good. Yeah. Solid number two and three.
Yeah.
Love those songs.
Yeah. I still think Take on Me might be my favorite musical of all time. Or music video of all time.
It's just 90 minutes long. Proud of your boy.
Yeah, it's a great video, and also the literal translation one is also good with the pipe wrench fight.
Yeah.
So
most of those literal music videos kind of crappy. That one's good though.
That one's really good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Big fan.
But yeah. So strap the fuck in, because we're gonna talk about Jem. We are on the rocket ship from second one of this show, right?
Hell yeah.
You know, you've got the music video. There's bands all over the place. There's talk of fashion. It's very clearly established that Jem is her name.
In some instances, it's Jerrica. The song is a lie.
What if the song just like inserted, my real name's Jerrica? Like just kind of snuck it in there.
Live in America.
I support it.
This is the most 80s ass show, right?
Yep.
I don't know if we've watched anything else that is more 80s than Jem. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. I mean, New Kids on the Block is close, but that's a 90s show.
Yeah, wasn't that 1990?
That was the most 80s ass show of the 90s, baby.
Yeah.
I'm gonna harp on this a little bit. Casual misogynistic applications of things like glitter and fame. Mm-hmm. That's what girls like. Girls like glitter and pink throughout this whole all
and
of
stars gym. And fireworks and
yeah. It's like girls are capable outfits. Of things by deception, but not by real means. The men are in charge.
Yeah. Do you know what else girls like? According to Jem. Being talked to in very creepy and horrifying ways, but we'll get there.
Yep.
Yeah. But it's a super memorable opening, for sure.
It's truly outrageous.
Yeah.
Truly. Truly, truly.
It's truly also outrageous that in a show about music, the opening song is less than a minute. So, bravo.
I guess it leaves room for more music later.
Yeah. I wonder, too, I'm just thinking out loud, if the song is shorter because they had less time to work with.
I was actually going to suggest that.
We're using our noodles here. Hmm. Yeah. History. So, the cartoon proper starts up, and we get a car pulling up, and people are freaking the fuck out. That's right. The band slowly gets out of the car. So we have Shayna, Aja, Kimber, and Jem herself. And the crowd just chants in this weird monotone timbre. It's interesting.
I mean, haven't you ever gone to a red carpet? That's what you do.
Yeah, I guess that's fair.
I had the same thought, but I put a different band in place of Jim and the Holograms. Like, what if it was Metallica coming out and people were just like, James, 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 Lars, Lars. just Aja, you can chant, and Jim is like that's a cool name to chant, but James, James, James.
Yeah, it's a little
that
weird.
Is all.
Mm-hmm. What I also loved about this particular scene is, so they're getting out on the red carpet and they're all fancy and there's flash bulbs and reporters and like the camera guy. And for some reason, instead of security, they just have a bunch of bellhops.
That's all you need. Maybe like, they're in disguise, you know, like air marshals.
But they're not, they're like publicly there in uniform and there's many of them. Like, it's not just one dude. It's like a group of giant, obviously security people in bellhop uniforms. Hmm. It's weird.
It's all weird.
Yeah.
Jem gets a microphone in her face and she gets asked how she feels about being famous. And she answers this with an internal monologue that is completely normal.
I remember how it all began with the unexpected death of my father.
Oh.
That no one in proximity to the microphone can hear.
Yeah. Now, to be fair, we did not watch the whole sort of run-up of this episode. This flashback never comes back.
That's true.
The whole episode is in flashback, I should say. So maybe this first part never comes up again. Like, it could have just started with the death of her father, but
then you wouldn't get all the character names so fast. Mm-hmm.
So it's a five-part series.
Right.
And, like, I haven't watched them either, but, like, I would hope that at some point at the end of the fifth part, she's back at the concert and finishing her answer.
I mean,
she ends up back at the concert.
Maybe, but
okay.
If you think about it, this is a five-parter, but it's really a 15-parter taking place over almost 4 months. So,
right, yeah.
They must send you back to that concert.
Yeah.
Like every week.
I don't know if it's every week.
You sounded so confident.
Well, I know there are other things I remember her saying, or like other things happening in that very specific scene that aren't there. So either I'm doing the thing that I sometimes do where I invent things and insert them, or more logically, they return. I'm confident they go back.
They return. Now,
this is the beginning.
Just to clarify too, so her dad died of causes unknown. Her mom has died in the past in a plane crash. So tragedy has struck the Benton family. But we go to the funeral and we meet Eric Raymond, who, oh boy.
You have my deepest sympathies, Jerrica.
Thank you, Mr. Raymond.
Please call me Eric. If I can be of any help, don't hesitate to call me.
Jerrica has all the help she needs, Mr. Raymond.
Rio means well. I appreciate the offer, Eric. Thank you.
Eric Raymond is the villain, which is clear, but he comes off so hashtag Me Too-ish.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Just a little bit.
Yeah.
So shares a voice with Starscream. That's important. Mm-hmm. Charlie Adler. He plays this character so effing creepy.
Yeah.
And then the animators took it another step and they actually have him touch her in this scene.
Yeah.
It really creeped me out.
Did you see the other detail too?
Which one?
He had a raging erection in his pants.
Oh, come on, Ben. Oh,
big old erector set. Yeah.
You betcha. So.
Oh, he's got a big old erector set there.
So Jerrica tells the audience that she has two inheritances, right? So she inherits a music company. She also inherits a foster home.
Yes.
What the fuck?
Makes sense.
How old is Jerrica?
I have no idea. I wrote down in my notes like many times, how old is this person?
Yeah. So I thought that she was like 14 here. Later on, I sort of revised it up a little, but you can't, it's tough to tell with a cartoon like how old somebody is.
Yeah. I think she's definitely, she's out of high school, but I couldn't tell you if that's by like a few days or like a decade.
Yeah. Okay. Dave, any thoughts on age?
I just, maybe it was more hope than anything else, but I was just hoping she was like 20 or older. Like,
yeah.
Because like the things that happen in this show, just anything younger than at least 20 would be weird.
I mean, it's weird anyway. Still, yeah. Yeah. For reasons that we will talk about.
Wait, where did you think I was going to go with that answer?
I think we were just reinforcing that it's also still weird.
Yeah.
Oh, like, yeah,
it's,
yeah.
It's
yeah,
less
yeah,
weird,
yeah,
but
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So they go to Starlight House, which is the foster home, where there are somewhere between 5 and 35 girls living there. It's not clear at any point if there is like a responsible party at the foster home. There's an older woman there whose name you don't get this episode, who appears to be kind of there, but
she comes back.
Yeah. Everybody. What's her name?
I don't know. I just know she does.
You can't just give me these half facts. You follow up.
Anyway,
spin your statement.
So here's the thing. We know that Jerrica takes over for adult in charge. I believe her father right. used to be, right? Like, that's the assumption you're supposed to draw.
Yeah.
And I'll point out at this foster home that she's owning and now running because she's inherited it. So she's inherited a burden.
Yeah.
What we learn immediately is that what the girls at the foster house like to do is clean.
Yeah.
They just clean.
Yeah. They clean. Yep. They're vacuuming while holding a drumstick. And they live in this house and apparently have, but the house seems like a shithole, I guess.
Yeah.
Have they not lived in it before? Does that come up?
Nope.
Huh. All right.
Yeah. So they inherited a dilapidated mansion.
Yeah.
Basically.
And,
yeah.
And what, so it's the start, what is it? The Starbright, Starlight, Starlight. Foster home. So it's the foster home. So apparently it's already established. And so there right. are already people there.
Yeah.
And so people are just living in squalor. Like, Jerrica's dad is a slumlord.
I mean, no, they don't live in squalor because what we know about girls is they like to vacuum and they like to dust and they like to sweep and sure. they like to scrub.
Sure.
To that be is fair, well established in that first shot.
To be fair, Jerrica was trying to fix the pipe under the sink. Now, she couldn't because women can't fix pipes, apparently, but she was trying.
Nor can cute boys fix electricity.
Boy, we
yes.
We've got some drops coming out of this segment here. So we also meet Rio in the scene, and Rio is Jerrica's love interest, and he's a real bohunk, right?
Oh,
he's
just got hunk.
Smoldering eyes, purple hair.
Oh,
dreamy everything a hunk needs.
Yeah. Anywhere between 18 and 40.
Yep.
Yeah.
We'll say hopefully he's close in age to Jerrica. We also get like the craziest animation I've seen in a few weeks here. There's a shot where Rio is walking and holding a ladder, but the shot is superimposed over everybody else in the house, like fixing the house up. So it just looks like he's walking in the middle of air.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yes. I loved it. it's like an optical illusion. But there's hijinks in the house, right? So there's pipes exploding. There's shorts in the wire. It's really weird. And it's at this point that the show gets a little confusing because Shailen, as you noted, she has a record company.
Yep.
What we need is money to fix this place up.
Well, your father always used to get money from Starlight Music to keep things going.
Hey, good. Then why can't I?
Hey, good.
You own half the company, Jerrica.
Yeah, and this is a constant point in this. Nobody seems to understand how money works.
Yeah. That's definitely true.
Yeah.
And like, so I love too that she has two inheritances. One is a horrible money suck
sure.
and she's been given no direction on how to support it or take care of it. There's no funding to help with it. We don't know if there's a mortgage, like all these things. Oh, and that other half that I've been ignoring that my dad's business partner has just been stealing from.
Yeah, it's weird too because Jerrica goes to Starlight Records and nobody seems to recognize her. It's weird.
Well, because he fires.
Yeah, but she didn't run into anybody else.
Oh, no one else. It's a big building. I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
That's fair.
With a cool ass elevator on the outside.
Oh, yeah.
Hell yeah.
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 So 80s. I love it.
All buildings have elevators like that. Cool ones, anyway. So she bursts in to see Eric and she asks for money, as you'll see here.
I need money for Starlight House. Father left half of the company to me.
Jerrica, darling, you're just a kid. I'm running the company now.
It's just a weird exchange.
And also begs the question of how the fuck old is she?
Yeah. I think I'm going to go with 20. We're going to settle with 20, just so we don't belabor the point. So Eric's stated goal is to make Starlight Records the best record company in the industry.
In the country.
Okay. Which seems okay.
Small goals.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's not very...
not the world.
Aspirational, yeah. Eric. Come on.
But he's going to do this by signing new talent. And here's where we meet the Misfits, who ride into the office on motorcycles. And they are Pizzazz, Roxy, and Stormer. And here's a quick clip of some of their music. I thought of something interesting about the music, and I want to run this by you both.
Okay.
So the Misfits are supposed to be bad, right?
Mm-hmm.
But their music sounds nearly identical to Jem's music.
Correct.
So it's very confusing.
They have more minor chords to indicate they're bad guys.
Come on.
It's true. Listen to the whole episode.
If you listen to the opening song that has both Jem and the Misfits, the music is nearly indistinguishable from each other.
Nearly. It's two sides of the same coin, good and evil.
Okay.
This raises a question that I had, though. Why is Jem such a jerk to the Misfits, and why are the Misfits such a jerk to Jem?
Yeah, they're calling each other trash and wimps. It gets very...
Yeah.
Instantly, they are catty toward each other. And this leads me to a point I was like just came across after watching the whole episode is Eric manipulates the Misfits to hate Jem and thusly manipulates Jem to hate the Misfits. Like these women have no agency. Like everything that they do is from, a man. It's either Eric or Rio or Jem's dead father. It's really, I watched the episode a couple of times. I was like, this is troubling.
Yep.
It's not very good. Not a very good role model Jem is.
Agree.
Mm-hmm. So the Misfits in their motorcycle chase...
Guitar-a-cycles.
Okay.
They're guitars.
Great, thank you. And their guitar-a-cycles chase Jem around and through the glass elevator and down the street. It's kind of a music video. Well, it is a music video. They have the little name of the song and the group on it, but... It's not
which cool. I thought was a nice touch. I like that.
Did you?
Yeah, it was just like kind of like a, I don't know, like a, it was like a nice little kind of element that set it apart from other cartoons.
At any point, did you question what group was playing and what the name of the song was? Because the name of the song is repeated 300 times, no matter what song it is.
No, I think it was called Out of My Way. Just taking a guess. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, never had any problem with that.
Mm-hmm. So... Jerrica leaves, and again, like it, she owns half the company. Whatever, we'll move on. But she goes home, and she's taken everything well in stride, at least.
But what can we do by tomorrow? Oh, Jerrica, I forgot. This came while you were out today. Let's see.
Everybody was played by a wooden block, I'll point out.
Yes.
Just no emotion in any of them. But Jerrica has a small box, has her name on it. I hate saying the name Jerrica. It's not a bad name. It's just, it's one of those names you say it a lot. It's a tongue twister.
Yeah, like porkaloin.
Yeah. Jerrica. Let's see.
Porkaloin.
One of my favorite people is named Jerrica, so it doesn't bother me.
I
think it's because I have a direct association, yeah, okay. So like...
I said it's not the name, it's just... it's.
Yeah, when you assign it to a weird 2D character who's basically a block, it's much more difficult than when it's a real human.
Mm-hmm. Signified.
Yeah.
It's weird that you have a favorite human who is a cartoon character, Shailen. You might want to reconsider your life choices there.
Don't judge me. She's great.
My favorite person is Tor the Worm.
Don't you make fun of my imaginary friend.
I wasn't. I was stating a fact. And that was you talking.
Mm-hmm.
I hate you.
So inside the box is a pair of star-shaped earrings. Jerrica loves them. She puts them on, and then the power goes out. And then a purple ghost shows up that looks like the woman from Weird Science, and... it gets a little randy.
Jerrica Benton, I have come for you.
So, it's a weird introduction.
Yeah, that's what I say to my cum rag right before I spooch.
Oh, God. Oh, no.
Let's add that to the list of things that not only did I never need to know it, but also we should never talk about again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And yes, I talk to my cum socks.
We'll put that on the drop reel.
Anyway, yeah, why is the line delivered like that? It's just like, without any visuals, I just like, you just picture her like cupping her hands and I have come for you.
Yeah, well, it's another creepy line.
Yeah.
With the visuals, it's still creepy. Just throwing that out there.
Yeah, because as she's saying it, we see a shocked Jerrica in the screen freeze frames for like an hour.
For like a really long time.
Which makes a little more sense knowing the context of how this was originally broadcast, because right. I think that would have been the first cut. But
yeah.
when you're just watching it as part of the episode, it's wild. So the girls all get in a van and they drive to the Star Drive-In, because everything in this show has to be star themed, right?
Correct.
And the drug trip continues.
Welcome, Jerrica Benton. Come. Continue to drive forward.
What? Through the wall?
Do not be afraid.
Because it's natural to not be afraid of driving into a concrete wall. But they do it. They go through. And one of the girls smells something a little bit fishy.
It's not real.
It's an illusion.
A trick is something a whore does for money.
I laughed so hard when she said that. It's an illusion. I watched this while I was commuting, and I was just getting off the subway, and I was just laughing maniacally, like walking in a crowd of angry people who wanted to go home, and I had to like walk to the side and catch my breath.
Sure.
It is because a trick is what whores do for money.
That's right. This is, of course, the introduction of Synergy. And Synergy is, I can't even explain it. I didn't get the full quote. Synergy is,
she's
an artificial intelligence construct that Jerrica's dad made for music purposes?
Yes.
Okay. All right. She gives us a little science babble. Do you want to hear that?
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
Through my remote micro-projectors.
The earrings.
Yes, through them I can create any hologram you desire. Your father left you other gifts as well.
I like that you could tell it's like a computer thing, because there's just all these... Like it's Star Trek from 1960. It's fucking... It's weird.
Yeah. And it's good too, because, you know, her dad left her two inheritances. Flex, three inheritances.
Yeah.
But the third one is full of gifts.
Well, this is the most implausible of all. So the earring...
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Many holograms.
I don't know why I answered that so seriously. No, Dave, it is.
Holograms.
Dave, you're never sarcastic.
This is just a show about a woman dealing with a foster home and an honor jar. As we'll get to.
I like, again, getting back to the point where Jem, the Misfits, any female character can't do anything on their own. Like a literal Deus Ex Machina comes in by way of her dead father and solves all the problems that she has.
That's correct.
Well,
with all the most important things that a girl needs to be successful.
I don't want to disagree with you. And you know what?
Okay.
Read your list. I have a counterpoint to this, though.
What a girl needs for success in life.
What a girl wants.
Holograms. Girl needs. Fancy clothes. Rock band equipment. And clothes.
Right.
And a car. And everything else, it just comes into place.
But
she just needs her dad to give her those ridiculous things.
Right.
But these four women are in danger of losing their lives literally every second of the show.
Yep.
So I will kind of disagree that all the problems are solved, because these poor women need like counseling or something for all the shit they go through in the next 15 minutes here. This is crazy.
Yeah, that's more money, more problems.
Yeah.
Can we classify it there?
Sure.
All right.
So her father does leave her gifts, right? These holograms that Synergy demonstrates by transforming the characters into each other for about 14 minutes. There's these
racks. It's so laborious.
It's insane. There's these racks of clothes, which were also holograms, I guess.
No,
those are real.
Yeah, Kimber actually says, and they're real, which is weird.
science in musical instruments and a big car that says Jem on it. So I guess we can assume that Jem was her nickname.
Sure.
We'll go with that.
So another question that I have.
Yeah.
Her dad owned a record company and left her half of it.
Sure.
Why did it take until Synergy showed up for her to say, guitars and stuff for a band? Like, ostensibly, a record company that does recording should have that equipment. And if she owns half the company, she should have had access to that without the hologram.
Maybe Synergy was busy.
Yeah. It's, I mean, this whole show is not a flattering depiction of females.
I'm just saying, like, particular thing rang to me as like, what the fuck? Right. Why do you hate women so much?
Yeah. And so thank you for bringing up the Battle of the Bands, because I left this out earlier.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So Eric's whole plan on getting Starlight Records and the Misfits to number one is by staging and rigging a Battle of the Bands.
In the park.
How this would work, not clear, but somehow it does, as we'll get to in a second here. So Jem and her pals are astonished at their newfound wealth. And then we go to the Battle of the Bands. And here we are introduced to a group of folks that is sadly underrepresented, and that is the Limp Lizards. I loved the Limp Lizards. They had like crocodile costumes on. They played a song called Broken Glass. It was fantastic.
I love the reaction they got. Like, who actually goes to a concert and just boos the fuck out of the artists?
Yeah.
Like, usually you just get no reaction. These people are like, get off the stage, you losers. Mm-hmm. Boo.
Well,
I like that.
It's so good.
And as they're singing Broken Glass, there are people literally throwing glass bottles at them.
I thought that was them breaking the glass, but maybe not.
Oh,
yeah.
That might make more sense.
It's experimental.
Yeah. All right.
What you can say about the crowd at this Battle of the Band, it's not big. There might be 50 people, but they are so loud and so enthusiastic, right?
Yeah.
So they're booing the shit out of the Limp Lizards, which Erector said. And Eric is about to declare the Misfits the winners when all of a sudden, from another stage that was constructed without anybody seeing it in the broad daylight,
it's a hologram.
Good call.
Yeah,
we get this. Ben. We get this song. I'm so pissed you broke my train of thought about that stage. I had a whole setup about how it was bullshit that stage is there, and you just cut it out from under me.
I'm sorry.
Anyway, I'll get over it. This song is so good, as you could just tell. The crowd is sprinting across the field, and the music video for the song involves Jem and the Holograms playing a claw machine game.
That's right.
It is so weird.
Yeah. Were those big in the 80s?
Claw machines?
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Like, oh, fuck, we got to draw a claw machine. Like, kids love claw machines.
I feel like in a lot of movies that happen on, like, boardwalks and things like that, there's always a claw machine.
I will say, if I walk by a claw machine now and I have money to do so, I will play the claw machine.
It's like quicksand. Like, in the 80s, you were led to believe that quicksand was going to be a much bigger problem in your life than it ever turned out to be. It was like a thing that showed up in all kids' shows. There's a quicksand episode in almost every TV show in the 80s.
What does that have to do with a claw machine?
I'm saying the claw machines, too.
Are claw machines
a
problem?
The claw machine is as ubiquitous as quicksand.
That's correct.
Okay. I put it together.
Thank you.
You're welcome, listeners. You're welcome.
Okay. I knew what I meant.
All right.
Piecing things together.
I saw, like, when I was watching this episode, I actually remembered this song. So that tells you how good it really was.
Mm-hmm. It's great.
Only the beginning.
It was number one in contextual
only
feeling.
So
the crowd is going fucking apeshit. Like, they're just going bonkers. And Jem and the Holograms think they've won. But Eric comes back.
You can't play here! This is my invitation only!
Son of a bitch.
And we immediately have to do like a Superman Clark Kent switcheroo when Jem says, She told me. And she points, and then she touches her earring to manifest a hologram of Jerrica on the other stage. And then she has to sprint to the other stage before Eric gets there.
It's cumbersome.
David Copperfield, she is not with these illusions.
It's her first day.
Yeah, I was going to say, she just got these earrings. Like, she needs to figure them out. Mm-hmm. What's the most efficient way I can project my holograms to trick Eric Raymond?
That's fair. So, to this point, with the death and the creepiness and the holograms and the foster home, your head might be spinning a little bit. This is where we hit the next level.
You think you can run the company better than me? Then I challenge you. In 6 months, I'll make the Misfits more popular than Jem. Then we'll have another battle of the bands. If Jem wins, you get Starlight Music. But if the Misfits win, Starlight Music is mine.
I accept that challenge.
Let me paint a picture. They're standing on the stage, and the loudspeaker catches this, and there are cameras flashing and taking pictures of all of this. So their gambit is that either the Misfits or Jem will win this next battle of the bands and be the biggest band.
Yes.
And they're staking the entire company on this.
Uh-huh.
Makes sense so far.
I mean, I'm following. I don't know that it makes sense.
Right.
Is this something that, like, a crowd of people there for a concert would actually care about?
Yes.
Clearly, you heard the reaction.
Yeah, I mean, people are losing their
minds. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
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 Oh my God, the record label. Ah.
Well,
it's like the last thing I would think about.
If that's not enough, it gets even weirder.
Allow me to sweeten the deal. I'm Howard Sands. I'm a film producer. I'll give a movie contract to the group that wins this contest. And the winners will also get this magnificent mansion.
Holy fuck, yeah!
What the fuck is going on? This dude shows up. He looks like Rusty Jones. And he offers them a movie deal and a mansion?
And he's surrounded, like, by bodyguards. Like, there are these men, like two giant men next to him, like, wearing these, like, very reflective sunglasses. Like, very stoic and brick-like.
I really hope that someday I can find some kind of talent that will make it so I can just go to the park for a nice stroll, stumble upon a battle of the bands turned into a crazy fight for a giant company, and then offer up $1 million movie contract and a fucking mansion to strangers that I've only just acknowledged existing about 12 seconds before.
See, you're overthinking it because what we need, right? Mm-hmm. So we need a competing podcast with about the same number of listeners that we have, and we'll get together in the park.
We'll have a podcast
and
off.
A film producer will just appear.
Ooh, how do we arrange this?
Now, we would certainly lose.
It's watch bots versus watch thoughts.
I mean, I
patent pending.
I know some people with roughly similarly sized podcasts. Let's make this happen. Throw it out of the park.
We're not in a spot to be competing with people.
Especially not if it's physical activity, because I have very bad asthma.
We love everyone. So, yeah. These stakes are patently ridiculous. Like, it's so crazy. Now,
every time I karaoke, a movie producer comes up to me and offers a massive mansion. It's 50% of the time it happens.
Yeah, it's like every time you take gets its wings.
Yeah, exactly.
same. Now, the Misfits immediately throw Jem's stuff into the A-Team van and drive off. And Jem and the holograms chase them onto a cliff where it seems that they are going to die.
We're gonna hit the cliff!
This is another spot where the pacing was really weird, but I can forgive it knowing what happens. So, like,
they leave you on a literal cliffhanger. It's not even subtle.
Yeah. And then John Lithgow came and
get out.
You know,
Michael Rooker was there wearing a cool sweater.
A good time was had by all. So this is that classic thing where the rockin' roadster is hanging half on, half off a cliff. And it seems like they're going to die, but fortunately somebody yells out that they should hit the brakes. So they're just hanging there, right?
Which is the dumbest line I've ever heard.
Yeah.
They're like, hit the brakes. Yeah. Like, oh, does Jim not know how to drive? Mm-hmm.
Maybe
or
not.
Or whoever's driving the car.
We don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's
these
girls
she
were
is
poor.
A woman.
They were, and right? Woman driver.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If the show has taught us anything, women can't do much.
Yeah.
As exhibited by the next plot point. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I'm not sure which plot point you're talking about.
They can't save themselves, so they do a hologram projection to get Rio to save them.
Okay. To be fair, I will play devil's advocate. They tried to stand up and move, and the car was falling further off the cliff. So at a point, you kind of hang out and use the resources you have.
Because they're all too dumb to understand the physics of backing the car up and not letting it fall off the cliff. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, let's not continue to litigate. Just for the sake of time. So they send out Jem's projection. And Shailen, you mentioned this. Rio shows up. Whether that was happenstance or just a good stroke of luck, I don't know.
I thought that they projected Jem to Rio to see. Like, I think that's something Synergy can do, is like locate where they need to send the hologram.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought that was the show. Like,
okay,
they projected to Rio, but Rio was very, very close. Like, what was he doing there?
He was at the Battle of the Bands,
at the park.
Oh, was he?
I don't know.
Okay,
sure,
maybe.
You said that with such a Shailen certainty.
Never trust that. Yeah. That's always a lie.
So we do get a good pun at least.
Everyone okay?
Yeah, we just felt like hanging around.
Well, hang tight. Amazing rescue.
As if one Hagen reference wasn't enough, you needed two within a span of 3 seconds. Pack those jokes in where you can find them, I guess. So Eric scolds the Misfits for fucking up, you know, by stealing all the equipment and giving Jem all of that free publicity. And the Misfits play another song, which I did not clip, but I did note that the singer of the Misfits is wearing a sash because they're at a beauty pageant, and she is Miss Beha, Beha. I don't know what that is. Yeah,
I think it was like I think there was a fold in the sash, and I think it's supposed to be Miss Behave.
Oh, okay.
Miss Beha.
Yeah.
I was about to speculate that if I looked up Beha on Urban Dictionary, it would be some kind of like dick slapping thing.
I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
Miss Beha, a distant cousin to the Blap. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Also, in this in that scene, they animate Eric to look like he's like moving around in his hair at one point, like looks like devil horns.
Mm-hmm.
It's really quite obvious and
subtle.
Little on the nose.
Yeah,
a little bit.
And for a show noted for subtleties, it's really surprising.
Right. Exactly. Up until this point, it's been very down to earth.
Now we go back to Starlight House, where we are introduced to the single most important thing in the series, as far as I can tell.
That's $3 from Botany.
I walked Mrs. Letcher's dog.
Deirdre?
$10 cutting lawns.
I don't get it. How come you're giving them all your money?
We're not giving it to them. It's for the honor jar.
The fucking honor jar. So
This
house is so poor that they have to pool all their money, and the girls who live there have to do labor to buy a refrigerator. This honor jar comes up conservatively 250 more times in the next 10 minutes.
Where did you get the plot point that they needed to buy a refrigerator with the honor jar? I missed that completely, and I was just like, what the fuck is this honor jar for?
I think it's right before the clip I just pulled, or right after.
Like, they say we're going to use this money for a new refrigerator.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I could not. I must have just kept missing it or blocking it out or whatever. Mm. I was just like, why the hell are they so concerned about this honor jar? Just looks like a swear jar with money. Like, I couldn't tell.
It's in the clip.
But
yeah.
All right. But thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'll point out that the house has no electricity. So they're going to buy a refrigerator that's more of an icebox, I think.
It's the 30s. It's fine. Now, Eric hires somebody to do some bad things. And I will play this in a minute. The guy that he calls looks like Geordi LaForge from Star Trek Next Generation, except white.
And blonde, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
He looks like Scared Stiff from the Ghostbusters, just with flesh.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that'll play.
Yeah. Yeah.
But let's listen to this stirring criminal enterprise.
Remember, I just want you to make her nervous.
Hey, making people nervous is my specialty.
Jesus Christ.
Everything about that is just not okay.
Yeah. But this is not the only criminal that we have, because one of the girls living in Starlight House, who again is not named as far as I can tell, but she looks like a real punk rocker. She looks like Bad News. She tries to steal from the fucking honor jar.
Bitch.
Ooh,
look at that.
I was...
Put it back.
I was only going to borrow it.
This is one of those moments that I really like, because Jem and the holograms catch her, Jerrica in her usual form. And it's another one of those weird legal things. Let me play this too.
Since the money belongs to the others, I'll let them decide what to do with you.
So Jerrica,
democracy.
Jerrica doesn't have the goddamn balls to kick this thief out of the house. She leaves it to the other girls to decide, the other like 14-year-olds.
Yeah.
Right.
And
right.
They sentence her to make her earn the $30. And again,
at least she got her trial though.
Yeah, for sure. We don't see it, thankfully. Yeah. You know, that would have been a little dull, but so it goes. So they make her earn $30 back. And now it's getting to be the twilight hour. And Rio tells Jerrica that they have another night with no electricity, but he has a plug for her socket.
Gross. It doesn't say anything like that.
He more or less does.
I have come for you.
He offers to sleep on a couch. He's a gentleman.
He's a smooth motherfucker.
I'm sorry, Jerrica. You'll have to go another night without electricity, I'm afraid.
Thanks anyway, Rio.
Hey, maybe I should stay.
Yeah. Yeah, on the couch.
He says that.
I don't trust you, Rio Pacheco.
That's how it always starts, right? Mm-hmm. Hey, I could stay a little longer.
But then he and Jerrica start making out in front
maybe
of the kids.
It's cold outside.
Problematic. Oh, it's interesting, Dave, that you made that noise.
Jealous?
I love a good smooch sound effect.
Hey, Ben, lean in real close to your mic. You're welcome.
You know, noise doesn't come out of the microphone. It goes into the microphone.
I know.
I did put my beard really into the microphone. I don't know.
He really did lean in. It was pretty funny.
But I put the headphone to the microphone. Whatever.
You are so compliant, you big old cuck. Mm-hmm. Wow. Can't believe
Jesus
you.
Jesus Christ. What the hell is going on?
We just went down a road.
Hell yeah. So speaking of smooches, Jordy LaForge breaks into the house very loudly. Jerrica does not wake up, but the other girls do. And they go downstairs to confront him, where he is holding a candelabra, a clock, and something else. For some reason, he drops those things on the floor, which causes one of the girls to drop a candle.
A lamp.
Jordy, instead of leaving out the door he came from, sprints to the front of the house and leaps through the window, which I did pull a gif of. And then the house is engulfed in flames, and the girls are apparently doomed to death.
That's correct.
Hold it right there.
Get out of my way.
Oh, the lantern.
Next time I'm in trouble, I'm just going to yell, the lantern.
Jesus. That's really good.
Now, the episode is about 22 and a half minutes long. We are at the 19-minute mark when it says to be continued on the screen.
With the screen covered in flames.
Yeah.
So, Ben, before you, I know where you're going, but before you go on, what did you think was going to happen? Like you saw that there were 3 minutes left. What do you think there was going to be in that 3 minutes?
I was wondering, was it a PSA situation? Were we going to get long credits? Were we going to get sort of an intro as to where the show is going? I wasn't quite sure, but these things tend to be fairly formulaic.
Yeah, and I thought it was going to be like another music video and then the end credits, something like that, like a little coda at the end or something. Yeah.
I think.
But where did it go?
I think I can say, without many reservations, that the next 3.5 minutes may be my favorite 3.5 minutes we have watched for this show. This is so fucking dense. right? Yep. Now,
oh, I love it.
It's really good.
We'll see. We'll see how long this takes. There is so much that happens here. So we cut back, right? The previous scene was the house is engulfed in flames. The girls are certainly going to die. We come back to Rio and Jem on a boat diving for treasure, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep.
And
yep.
We get this music playing. I will underscore that is considered good music. Jem and the Holograms is considered good. Now.
Like a dream.
Like a dream come true.
Ben, I would you should just give the listeners just, you know, the authentic kind of feeling that we had and just run through the clips because it's pretty much everything.
you want to just,
you know, just blow through them and we'll get to the end.
All right. Yeah. Y'all are in a hurry. But you know what?
We'll talk about it.
It's better this way.
Yeah.
All right. So we have in succession coming up 8 clips. Let's see how badly this goes. Number one.
Well, now that we've got this great place, I guess I can forget about the $30 you say I owe the honor jar.
No way.
Number two.
I want in there so bad I could scream. There's gotta be a way.
You need in and I need $30. Is it a deal?
For the honor jar, clip 3.
The misfits. Pizzazz! Roxy! Get out! Run! There's a bomb! A bomb!
May I present...
A bomb!
A bomb! Clip 4.
The Countess Danielle de Voisin.
You must all come to my party tonight. It's on my yacht. Please say you'll come.
Clip 5.
Shayna does.
I do?
Oh, yes.
Well, let's find a quiet corner and talk about
it. Rio?
Clip 6.
Do you like me?
I hardly know you. And you won't even tell me who you are.
Maybe I should tell you. Rio, I'm...
Clip 7.
We're making mischief.
Fuck. Clip 8. The end.
What is it?
A yacht headed straight for us. Sound the alarm.
So a lot happens here, right?
What you've just played is exactly how it rolled out. Like, there's nothing in between that we lost, really.
No. Yeah, it just cuts from clip to clip to clip.
Get out of there. Yeah. There's a bomb.
It's so wild.
Countess. Blah, blah, blah.
So, yeah.
It's so terrible.
So, to spin the narrative really, really quickly, like Micro Machine Man style, right? So, we get Jem and Rio on the boat, and then it cuts to the girls are now living in a mansion, which I believe is the movie mansion.
It's the movie star mansion. Yeah.
And they talk about the honor jar. And then the misfits pay to get in through the honor jar. And then there's a bomb. And then they meet a countess. And then they're on a boat talking about a music video where Shayna is led away by another very creepy man. And then Jem tries to seduce Rio. And then they're sprayed in the face with seltzer. And then the misfits are singing about making mischief. And then they try to crash a yacht. Now, here's the thing. I assumed... in watching that 3.5 minutes, that it took place over a lot of different episodes.
Oh, no.
That is the next episode. That is all in the next episode.
Yes, that is one bonkers episode. I'm going to watch it right after this one. I haven't seen it yet. Have you?
No.
Either of you?
Not yet.
I am very interested, though.
So it's like when Nicolas Cage made Drive Angry 3D, where he was like, I'm going to make the most action-packed action movie that ever actioned. Mm-hmm. And that's what they did for part 2 of Jem. We are going to fill this with so many fucking things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With music in the middle.
Just crazy.
Yeah.
Just crazy.
It's one of the greatest previews ever. Like, it just not in just cartoons, but like ever.
Sure.
It, like, I'm just, I'm just like, I'm fascinated by it. I'm hooked. It worked. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It did. Sorry, our cat's cleaning his asshole. It got very distracting.
Y'all can find a picture of it on Instagram later.
Yeah, nothing weird about taking a picture of that.
You can't
It's fine.
I'm at a good angle. It's artful.
I'm at a good angle.
It sounds like your cat's making mischief.
Indeed he is. So that is Jem. Let's do our rating thingy-ma-do here. Would you show it to a child? Ansel Adams. That's you.
That's me?
Because you're taking a picture.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
it's
clever.
I wouldn't show this to a child until they were old enough to understand all of like the anti-woman stuff that I would have to explain. So later in life, child, like 9.
35.
An explanation is like what not to watch.
Or like, this is fun and enjoyable on the surface, but look at all of these bad messages that it sends.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Dave?
I would not show this to a child. I don't know. I don't even know how this show is aimed at children to begin with. Like, there's nothing that like little kids would like out of the show aside from what my sister said. Mm-hmm. You know, the cool hair and the colorful outfits and all that. Yeah. Also, the show reminded me like it was kind of a cross between Josie and the Pussycats and Swan's Crossing. Did anybody else get that?
Yes.
You're forgetting Barbie and the Rockers. It's a three-way tie. Right. Mm-hmm.
So, no. Wouldn't show this to a child.
That's a three-way I would support.
Oh, gross.
As opposed to all those other ones I wouldn't support. Anyway, I also would not show it to a child for these same reasons. Let's go with 1 to 5 strong, empowered women. And Shailen, you may kick us off.
Oh, I don't think there are any strong, empowered women here, but I would give it 3 and 3.
3 and 3?
3 sparkly magical hologram earrings.
Okay.
No empowered women.
I
thought the mic cut out or something. Like 3 and 3.
I stuttered.
3
God,
and 3.
God, you guys both suck.
I'm sorry. Sorry. I never mess up, so.
Dave, what would you give it?
For all its problems, I would give the show a 4 out of 5. It's bananas. It's not good at all, but I would watch this whole run just to laugh my ass off at it. Yeah.
So if we're talking values, it gets a 0. It's shockingly devoid of value, but we don't watch the show for value, like us specifically. Like, we watch this to have fun, and like, why fuck around? This is a 5-star show. Like, it is so crazy. I absolutely will watch more of it. You know, it's great. It meets the purpose of making me laugh and filling 22 minutes of my dark day with brightness. And I appreciate that.
For me, this is like looking back into a time capsule. Like, what's in the time capsule isn't very, very good. Mm-hmm. But it reveals a lot about what was going on back then when it was buried. That's Jem for me.
That's fair.
I feel like time capsules in and of themselves are, this is corny, like time capsules of the age. Like, do people do time capsules anymore? I don't think so.
I don't know. Shailen?
There was an episode of Parks and Rec about one, so maybe in like small Midwestern towns.
I remember on Nickelodeon where they built Nickelodeon Studios at Universal Studios down in Florida, and they did the time capsule to commemorate it, and then they closed Nickelodeon Studios and they dug it up like 45 years early.
Whoops.
So... I don't know.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's cool. But Dave, you are our gamesman, gamesmith, gamesmaster, whatever. Why don't you clue us in?
Okay, so the episode that we just watched ended in a to be continued. And I thought that it would be fun to play with that theme. I love 2-part, 3-part, 4-part, 5-part episodes. Mm-hmm. And so I thought we'd play a game that we can either call Gemology or to be continued. And Ben, I'll let you choose the title there.
Do I have to do it now, or can I see how the game plays out?
Yeah, how about at the end?
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Shailen, you can choose too. I don't know why I just said Ben. I watched
because you watched too much Gem.
I was gonna say, yeah, you've been infected.
Jesus Christ, what's the matter with me? Hey. Anyway, so to be continued. Or Gemology. Here's how the game's going to go. We're going to go one after another. So Ben, you'll go first, then Shailen. God, Jem really affected me. But I'm going to read to you an episode description. and you're going to have to tell me what happens next. So, as an example, episode one, the beginning, Jem begins telling the story of how she and the holograms came to be. Jem gets in a war of wills and a battle of the bands with Eric Raymond and his musical act, The Misfits, culminating in a thief named Zipper setting the Starlight House ablaze. To be continued, what happens next? Is it A, yachts, bombs, and the song Like a Dream, or B, zebras, the song Because You Loved Me, and a character named Fancy? And then you would have to choose the correct to be continued, or the correct episode plot. Make sense?
Yes.
Because You Love Me, the song from Con Air. Because you love me.
You that is.
It is, actually, yes.
But yes.
Voice when I couldn't speak.
Now, you both know my wife, and I will say this, be upfront about this. My wife helped me write this game. So,
is that a warning?
Thanks to your wife.
Well, no, it's just she
mad up.
She threw in that Celine Dion song.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. Good taste.
So, Ben, you're gonna kick things off, Ben. So this is episode Frame Up, which is part four of the pilot that we just watched. Mm-hmm. In this episode, the holograms are scheduled to play a concert at a casino in Las Vegas. When they discover that the Misfits are their opening act, they start to worry. The Misfits bring along Ashley and use her to lure Aja away, hoping that if Aja isn't there, the holograms can't play and the Misfits will headline instead. Fortunately, Aja comes back in time and they perform. Unfortunately, while the girls are on stage, Eric Raymond's goons steal the money from the concert and plant the money in Jem's room, where the police find the money and arrest Jem. Stormer and Ashley team up to tell the truth, and Jen's name is cleared. To be continued. So, Ben, what happens next? Is it A, abandoned drive-ins, the song She's Got the Power, and hostage situations, or is it B, crashing helicopters, the song Torn, and Synergy becoming a cat?
I like the hostage situation.
You are correct. You get 1 point, yeah. Ben. Yes.
Truly outrageous.
And I'm not... Ben, you're truly outrageous.
That's true.
All right. I'm not going to read the plot of the next episode because it's way
best
too long.
Left unsaid.
Yes, yes. Shailen, you ready? All right. Star Bright, Part 1, Falling Star. Jem stars in Howard Sands' new movie, part of the prize she and the holograms won in the Battle of the Bands, spoiler alert. But Pizzazz convinces her father to buy the movie studio that is making the film and give ownership to Eric, who quickly seizes control of the film and adds the Misfits to the cast. Eric places the focus of the film on the Misfits, and Jem and the holograms are relegated to supporting roles. Finally fed up with the Misfits' disruptive and tyrannical behavior, Jem and the holograms, along with Video, quit the movie. But Jerrica receives shocking news about Starlight Girl Bonnie, who has been diagnosed with a rare optical condition that will leave her blind within a matter of months. To be continued. Shailen, what happens in the next episode? Is it A, a voodoo healer, a new bassist in the song Why Can't I? Or B, lasers, bankruptcy, and the song Love Is Doing It To Me?
B, lasers.
Shailen, you are correct. You get a point. And I'm actually writing this down.
What a gem.
Shailen.
Yes.
You're also truly outrageous.
Truly, truly, truly. Truly outrageous.
Question three for Ben. In Starbright Part 2, Colliding Stars, in this episode, horrified at the news of Bonnie's impending blindness, Jerrica learns from her doctor that there is an experimental laser surgical procedure that could save Bonnie's vision. However, the cost of the surgery is a staggering $250,000. That's fucking a lot of money. Having canceled all their tour dates to star in the movie, Aja hits on the idea to divert funds from Starlight Music to cover the cost. But when they arrive there, they find the building closed down and without power. Joni, the business manager of Starlight Music, tells the group that Eric has drained huge sums of money from Starlight Productions or Starlight Music. Left with no other option, Jem and the holograms are forced to return to the film. Eric's demands push the group to their limits, especially when Jim nearly falls from a set, which is suspended over several dozen feet in the air. A video records the accident, hoping to use it to shut down the film's production. But Jim pleads with her not to, because Ba needs surgery. During a dangerous motorcycle scene for the movie, Kimber is caught in the middle of a series of explosions set off by Roxy in Clash and is almost killed. She pleads with actor Nick Mann to save her, but he rides off and leaves her in the explosion. What happens in part three? Is it A, the song Kiss Me, a horrific car accident, and a PSA about telling the truth? Or is it B, surgery, the song Welcome to the Jungle, and box office bombs?
So I think it's B, but I will point out that Starlight Productions sounds like an old porno company.
Yep.
It does. So you're going with B?
Yes, I believe so.
Ben, you are truly, truly outrageous.
Jim is my name.
Ooh, Ben. Shailen.
I'm ready.
You ready for question four? In the Music Awards part one, the Holograms and the Misfits become so focused on beating each other at the upcoming annual Music Awards that they neglect their duties to the Starlight Girls. Deirdre, one of the girls, is so hurt by this, she runs away. Bonnie, not wanting Deirdre to go alone, decides to come with her, and Chrissy goes as well to keep an eye on them. Meanwhile, Video introduces the Holograms to Giselle Dvorak, a talented stage dancer who has a special request for them. Pizzazz persuades her father to buy a music company, which he does, and he opens it in a new building right opposite Starlight Music, which is named Misfits Music. Eric Raymond hires Tech Rat to cause trouble for the Holograms. The girls run away to the Misfits, who anonymously report that Jerrica is mistreating her Starlight Girls. The Holograms search everywhere for the Starlight Girls, but there is no trace for them. Feeling guilty for ignoring them, Jem decides to perform at the benefit anyway, with the hopes that the girls will hear about it and come home to be continued. Ben, what happens next? Is it A, the song Running Like the Wind, robbing an electronic store, or is it B, the song Truly Madly Deeply, and a holdup at a bank?
So since this is my question, I'm going to answer instead of Ben.
Oh, sorry, Shailen.
And the answer is
Ben was written
A.
It is A, yes. Sorry, Ben was written right under that question.
Yeah, sure.
And I hate women.
The way it should be.
Mm-hmm. Too much gem for you, Dave.
Yeah.
Whew. You need to find like a 2019 empowering lady cartoon.
I'll just watch She-Ra.
Yeah, new She-Ra.
The new one. Yeah, not the old one. Okay, this is the last question. It is a tiebreaker. How should we play this tiebreaker? Is it the first one to say the right answer? I'm going to buzz in.
This is your game.
Yeah. So that's what we're going to do. I'll need you to pick buzz in noises. So Shailen, what's your buzz in noise?
Oh, Jem.
I love it. Ben?
Jem is my name.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
In Jem Jam, part one, the Misfits plot to ruin the Jem Jam, a benefit concert Jem is planning, by hiring a group of thugs to gatecrash the party and trash the place to make Jem look bad at Starlight Mansion. At Starlight Mansion, Chrissy must deal with Lena Lerner's, a Tina Turner-like pop star, spoiled brat son, Dominic, who resembles a young Michael Jackson, and Bonnie is sure that Randy James, a red-haired drummer for the band, is her father. The episode also featured other celebrity stars, Roland Owens, who resembles Stevie Wonder, Ron Cox, who resembles Mick Jagger, and Johnny Deacon, who resembles Bruce Springsteen. The Misfits trick Jem's final guest, Luna Dark, who resembles Madonna, into coming with them. Jem sneaks into Pizzazz's mansion to rescue Luna, but she is attacked by Pizzazz's guard dogs. To be continued. So what happens? Is it A, guard dogs to the rescue, dog attacks, and the song You May Be a Star? Or is it B, the song Stay, a toad causing a person to fall into a pond, and a fake bomb threat at a bus terminal?
Jem is my name.
Ben?
It's B.
It is not B. It is A.
It's A. I win the tiebreaker.
You didn't buzz in.
I can't remember what my buzz in noise was. I got really excited and then I forgot.
I think it was ooh, Jem.
Thank you.
Shailen, you dethroned Ben. You won the game. You are truly, truly, truly outrageous.
Woo! All I had to do was forget my buzzer.
Yeah, I like that your successes are built on my failures.
There's a positive way to spin that, but I'm not sure of what it is right now.
I just did spin it positively.
That wasn't positive.
Ooh, Ben. Ben is misogynist. Ooh, Ben.
I don't think that that has played out at all this episode. I rate it on Strong Women.
Mm-hmm.
I like the lyric, Gem is my name, a lot.
So are you saying that because you like occasional women, you can't possibly be a misogynist?
I like occasional women. Like people who are occasionally women?
I don't know what I was getting at there. I misspoke. You occasionally like women. You occasionally don't hate women. Therefore, you can't be a misogynist.
Anyone who knows me knows I love the ladies. Love them.
There we go.
You're a married man.
Ben, Shailen, what's the name of this game? Is it To Be Continued or is it Gemology?
Oh, it's To Be Continued. We're going to use this again later.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Or we could put it out to Twitter as well. If you have a good name for Dave's game, hashtag Dave Name Game. One and the same. And
don't
not lame.
Be ashamed.
Dave is my name.
I really have this idea, and this is going to happen one of these days, where I'm just going to make us improv a song for the game.
Okay.
You know? But I have this fear / suspicion that we'll all blank, and like many segments, it will be actively bad.
Oh, you mean like the segment To Be Continued?
No, don't do that to yourself.
No, you're right. I won't. That's my therapist said not to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for playing.
And thanks for having us.
It was a good game.
Thanks. Yeah.
On to the mailbag. And we do have something today from the Effervescent Stranger.
Oh, sounds fun.
Indeed. Great show. Long time, first time. Quick question, then I'll hang up for the answer. You're presented with the four cartoon real Ghostbusters. Peter, Winston, Ray, and Blonde Egon. Who do you fuck, marry, kill, and, wipe? Well, I guess I'm not sure what wipe means in this scenario. Do we want to agree on a definition there?
Is it like helping a toddler to wipe their butt? Like, it could
be. Or helping an elderly person wipe their butt?
Okay, it could be. I was thinking like wipe down with baby oil.
Ugh.
Why is that? Why is that what popped into mind first?
I don't know. Maybe uncomfortable though. So,
or is it wipe down with baby poop?
I mean, that's insane. Nobody would do that.
Yeah.
So we'll just
assume scatological.
Wipe refers to doing something icky, like not pleasant and icky.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well, who wants to take a shot?
I think Shailen should go first because I'm not sexist, and I think women are great.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So you marry Egon because he's stable.
Uh-huh.
You kill Ray to put him out of his misery because he's a dum-dum.
Okay.
Who does that leave me?
Peter and Winston.
You fuck Winston, and you do something gross to Peter and set him out on the sidewalk. He deserves punishment for being who he is.
Okay.
All right, boys, what do you think?
I'm going to marry Winston.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Uncle Winston.
I'm going to fuck Peter, just like Janine and every other woman in that cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to kill Ray. I agree with Shailen. Just useless. And I'll wipe Egon.
All right.
Okay. So I will fuck Peter because he is seemingly skilled.
Okay.
I will marry Ray because docile and, you know, subservient, like a good partner should be. I will kill Egon because he's a fucking jack off, and I will wipe down Winston because I think he would understand. You know, no hard feelings.
He'd get it.
Yeah.
Yeah, he'd get it.
Yeah, yeah,
all right.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, we're in this together.
Mm-hmm.
I know you have to do this. Thank Winston. You for not killing me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You wipe Winston, and Winston wipes you, and you just never talk about it again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good question, effervescent stranger.
Mm-hmm. And
a bubbly one.
If you want to get at us on Twitter with your FMKW, hashtag I ain't afraid of no wiping.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. Or if you want to get on the mailbag, email at watchbotspod.com. mailbag@gmail.com. So, any last thoughts before we put Jem to the side?
I have to say, I was surprised. Makes me feel like I probably learned a thing or two since I was four. So that's good.
Mm-hmm. No last thoughts. Okay. No last thoughts here.
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Truly outrageous. Music's contagious. Jem is her name. And I think that's all that needs to be said. So you can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Jiffy at WatchBotsPod. Please subscribe, rate, and review on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever the fuck you're downloading your podcast. It's all good. For Dave and Shailen, this is Ben. Thanks for listening to another episode of WatchBots. And until next week, if life gives you a dead dad, make yourself a rock band out of his life's work. Bye.